Love has become a cliché. Sometimes we say that we love, but do we even know what that means? So, what does it mean to love God and love your neighbor as yourself? Coming up on Cross Connection. Welcome to Cross Connection. We continue our exploration of the life of Jesus in the Gospel according to Mark. And today's study is all about Jesus and the opposition. Our passage tells us about Jesus being confronted by three groups of people: the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the scribes. All three groups tried to trap Jesus, but the approach of the scribes is particularly interesting because they ask a question that is still very popular today. What is the greatest commandment? The response of Jesus is following: love your God with all that you have, and love your neighbor as yourself. And that's the subject of today's question. What does it mean to love God with all that you have? Let's get connected on Facebook, on Twitter, on email, or shoot a quick text to our number 707-200-1075. We are looking forward to hearing from you what you have to say about it. And I am blessed because we are joined today by Jillian, Dennis, Jennifer, and Diego. Yes. And Sergio, unfortunately, is not with us, but he will probably be joining us over this telecast. So today's discussion is a very, very interesting discussion because we will be diving deep into Gospel according to Mark chapter 12. Sorry, thank you so much. Chapter 12.
I'm not ready for 13.
Exactly,
yet.
Chapter 12. Yeah, because very good. I was just testing you. So it's definitely chapter 12. And it's a very interesting chapter. In fact, I think it's one of my favorite chapters in the Gospel according to Mark. And I hope it will become your favorite as well. So make sure to be with us till the very end. And before we do that, let's say a quick prayer. And Jennifer, could you pray for us?
Sure. Dear Father in heaven, thank you for this opportunity to study your word, and we just ask that your Holy Spirit be with us in a powerful way. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Okay, Cross Connection is all about getting into the word. So this is what we will do right now. So let's get into the word. And we are, we are in the temple now, with Jesus in the temple. So imagine that we are sitting in the temple that is right behind me, and the same very temple is right in my, like right here.
Wow.
Temple. If we cannot go to temple, the temple can come to us.
Wow.
Okay. Temple comes to us.
That's actually a really nice model.
It is a nice model, and I spent about 8 hours building it, literally. Yes.
Brick by brick.
Exactly, brick by brick, literally. So it was built by me and my wife, and and it's what where we are right now. We are somewhere in the surrounding of this beautiful edifice. So we are around this territory, somewhere right here, as you can see at the temple behind me. So this is where Jesus was, and this is the last week of Jesus's life. And right now we are probably in Tuesday. So imagine on Sunday, what did Jesus do on Sunday? We call it
Triumphal entry,
exactly. Mm-hmm. Triumphal entry. On Monday, according to the Gospel, according to Mark, he cleansed the temple. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then on Tuesday, he came back to the temple. So we are most likely on Tuesday. Mm-hmm. And in two days, on Thursday night, they will have a Last Supper, and then Jesus will be crucified on Friday.
Very good.
This is the chronology in Mark's Gospel.
And one thing good too, it's kind of building up, right? He enters into Jerusalem, and probably on the same time, on the other side, Pilate will come in Jerusalem. But he goes to the temple the next day, he cleanses everything, and surely some of the guys there that are the heads of the temple, they're saying, who is this guy here?
Yes.
What is he doing here, right? So the tension is building up upon Jesus.
And that is a very important point, because right in the previous chapter, if you look at the heading of chapter 11, the last passage in chapter 11, it even says that Jesus' authority was questioned.
Yes.
So who are you? Because who gave you the authority to do what you do?
Yes. Mm.
And so the first group of people that approaches Jesus is, it's actually the parable. Mm-hmm. Jesus tells them the parable. So there was a question about authority, and now Jesus tells them a parable. And Jennifer, could you tell us give us a quick text of Mark chapter 12, verses 1 all the way through verse 12, but a quick text.
Sure. So basically what's happening in Mark chapter 12, verse 1 through 12 is that there is a vineyard owner and he sets everything up for the vineyard to run properly, puts a wall of protection around it, creates a wine press, and then he leaves some tenants in charge. Mm-hmm. And then at some point in the future when this vineyard should be profitable, he sends people to collect the money. Mm-hmm. And when the people that he sends to collect the money come, they're treated very badly. And then ultimately he sends his son, and his son is also treated the same way.
In the same way or even worse?
A little.
Even worse.
Yeah, his son
was literally killed.
Yeah.
And thrown out of the vine.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So, just imagine that we are now the Pharisees or scribes or the Sadducees. It's very difficult to imagine because it's not us, it's somebody else.
It's always someone else, right?
But if we lived in that culture, do you think that we would immediately understand what Jesus is talking about?
Yes.
Why do you say so?
Well, because it, as Jesus often does, subtly or blatantly, it recalls a similar analogy, metaphor, whatever it is, that was used in Isaiah, and you're going to have to tell me what the verse was.
Oh, very interesting. And let's read in verse 12, the same chapter. So we're in Mark chapter 12, verse 12, for one second, and then we will go to Isaiah.
Yeah.
Jennifer, could you read for us 12?
Sure. In Mark chapter 12 is totally consistent with what she's saying, and it just says that, and they sought to lay hands on him, but feared the multitude, for they knew he had spoken the parable against them. So they left him and went away.
Wow. So the Jewish religious leaders, what did they immediately recognized?
They knew Jesus was talking about them.
So Jesus was talking about them. Okay, so why does who they were in this parable then?
The religious leaders.
Well,
in the parable, they were the tenants.
Yeah,
the
they tenants. Were the caretakers.
Yes, Israel.
Okay, and vineyard is Israel. Okay, let's go to Isaiah chapter 5, verse 7.
Thank you.
Yeah, chapter 5, verse 7.
Let's give some light into our study.
Yeah, because again, they knew their Bibles very well. Wow. Isaiah chapter 5, verses. We can read verse 2 and then verse 7. Isaiah and Julian, could you read for us verse 2 and then verse 7?
Okay, this is verse 2. He dug it up and cleared out its stones and planted it with the choicest vine. He built a tower in its midst and also made a wine press in it. So he expected it to bring forth good grapes, but it brought forth wild grapes.
So can you see that? Like, what do you see that there is? It's very similar to what Jesus is talking about.
Yeah, he uses a lot of analogies about fruit and the good or the bad or the
and planting it, expecting good fruit, and it's like he's preparing everything. Preparing all the environment to produce good fruits, but eventually it's produced.
But if you even go further in verse 7, it says, he looked for justice, but behold oppression, for righteousness, but behold a cry for help.
But read the entire verse 7.
Yeah, and then it says, and so for the vineyard, and this is Isaiah chapter 5, verse 7, so people can follow along. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah are his pleasant plant. He looked for justice, but behold oppression, for righteousness, but behold a cry for help.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So what do you see? Like, can you see that those two parables, they can be literally put one next to another?
Sure.
You would say, oh, of course, it's just the same parable
that
Jesus is
saying. I don't think he could be more clear.
Exactly.
Yeah, nothing can be more clear. And it's clear here that what they want is power, and they're using their power in an oppressive way.
Yeah.
And so the people are crying out for help, and God sends Jesus.
This is just amazing.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah, that is true, because, I mean, when you look at the Jews at that time, they were being, in a sense, oppressed by the Roman government. Mm-hmm. And so they were looking for, as Jennifer said, that freedom from the oppression. Mm-hmm. And here it is, he sends Christ, his only son, to free them. He says, remember, I come to them who are in captive at liberty, and to heal the brokenhearted, and to bind up their wounds. And here he is coming to fulfill that, and still they couldn't even recognize it.
But they were not only being oppressed by the Romans, the religious leaders were themselves the oppressors.
Yes.
And it was all about power.
Uh-huh. Exactly.
Which is why I think back to Mark chapter 12, verse 7, it says, but those vine dressers said among themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and the inheritance will be ours. So what is this inheritance? It's all of these people following after them instead of following after Jesus, because they wanted the power and the attention and the glory.
Exactly.
But, and then Jesus, so we can,
sure.
Thank you so much, because you've presented it so well. So what we see that religious leaders of the time of, in the time of Jesus, they were literally oppressing others. And this, when Jesus presents this parable, he says, no, what you will do, I've sent a couple of prophets to you. You killed a number of them, such as John the Baptist that we just read recently.
They were all rejected, yeah.
He was rejected as well, because he cried out to you, repent, for the kingdom of God has come near. And they say, no, we enjoy our kingdom better than your kingdom.
Exactly.
Yeah. Exactly.
They didn't want to remit to God what was God's. They liked what they had built up for themselves.
Exactly. And they would of course, oppose anything that would threaten their kingship.
Their power.
Power.
Would take their wine.
Yes, absolutely. They would take their money, whatever they
right.
take.
Yeah.
Do you think it also relates to our lives today? How can it be? Like, is this passage
absolutely.
Only for the Jews in the past?
Oh, yeah.
It does relate.
How?
Totally.
You can see, because you see how many attempts that he made to send individuals to help them. And he says that they killed them, they stoned them, and so on and so forth. Then he sent his only begotten son, and they still rejected him. Mm-hmm. And when you look at the character of God, it's so interesting in 2 Peter. Chapter 3, it says how the Lord is not slack, you know, concerning his promise, but he's long-suffering. Mm-hmm. And you can see his willingness that they shouldn't perish, but that they should come to repentance.
Wow.
It's like he was sending all of these attempts to try and bring them to gather them, and still they rejected him.
And I think we often do that every day, whether it's not seeing a blessing that God has given, or, you know, even what you do unto the least of these, my brethren, you do unto me. We miss out on that. We reject it in our hearts, in our minds. It's not a physical crucifixion, but in our own lives, we're saying, no, I like the kingdom that I've built here.
Yes.
I like my comfort zone. You stay over there. I like my vineyard.
I would say even more specifically, though, whenever someone has religious influence, there is a danger that they're building their own kingdom instead of pointing people to God. And that is oppressive. So, and whenever you're not pointing people to God and you're trying to get the attention for yourself, you're following the example of these religious leaders.
Yeah. Well, one thing also, I think it's just mentioning what everybody has already said, but it reveals also two things, I believe, the character of God and the character of man. The character of God, why? Because he's constantly sending someone else,
yes,
and they kill them and they beat them up. And now, I would never even consider sending my son because, well, they've treated him so badly, but he's showing what? His love. On the other hand, reveals our character. You know, power, struggle, position, they don't change who we are. They merely reveal who we are. Because remember, before Israel, it was captive. They were crying out for God. As soon as at least some of them receive some power, what happens? The oppressed immediately becomes what?
The oppressor.
And this is like a red flag for all of us in our lives. Sometimes we think, okay, I want freedom, or I want this in my life. When I get there, I know I'm going to be a good boss, or I'm going to be... And as soon as we start we're having some power, some influence, we have to be careful in our hearts, because as soon as we receive it, we'll be tempted to once oppress, now we become oppressor.
And do anything to maintain it.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, even kill.
Yeah.
That's very true.
This is so powerful. Thank you so much. I am truly blessed. It's just like, and after the break, we will continue talking about it even more, and we will even dig deeper, and we will try to understand why would Jesus even refer to the stone? Because he said, the stone that the builders rejected will become the cornerstone. This is just incredible.
Amazing.
And we will continue our discussion. We will take a short break, and this is a perfect time for you to join our conversation by sharing your thoughts on today's question. What does it mean to love God with all that we have? Welcome back. Once again, we learn how Jesus is turning the concept of this world upside down. He says, you know what? Look at your heart, because you need to be changed. You need to understand that don't be that vine dresser who just continues remaining in his own seat and just enjoys his own vineyard, because he thinks that this is your vineyard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But we forget that the world was created by God.
Mm-hmm.
And we are just the tenants of this world.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Stewards. Just tenants. Stewards and yeah. tenants. But we treat this world as our own property.
As our kingdom, yeah.
But even if God was not the creator, I would say to the person who would reject the fact that God created the world, mm-hmm. even then, you live in this world only for a certain period of time.
Exactly.
Don't yeah. treat this world as your own property.
Exactly. Yeah.
Remember that you will leave it to your children. Remember that there were people before you who left it for you. Mm-hmm. But most importantly, God is the one who created this world. God is the one who created the universe. Amen. Now, this is just incredible because Jesus refers to, he talks about the vineyard. And this is just, I need to point this out. Because where was Jesus telling this parable again? Remind me.
The somewhere temple. Over there.
Exactly, mm-hmm.
Somewhere
in the temple.
Over there.
Somewhere in there.
This
okay.
area.
Yeah.
Yes. So, but look at the crown of the temple. If you look at the crown of the temple, you may notice, not here, unfortunately, but you will know that this is where they had grapevines. Mm. Oh. So the crown of the temple was adorned with grapevines.
Mm. Tie it all together.
Wow.
And that's why if Jesus is telling the parable of the grapevines, of course they know what Jesus is talking mm-hmm. about.
Yeah.
Of course, because this is the symbol of Israel. Mm-hmm. This yeah. is them.
Wow.
So obviously the reaction was, oh, don't take this kingdom from us. We like this kingdom. And this is what sometimes happens to us as well. Mm-hmm. But look what happens then. Jesus also mentions something. He says in verse 10, and Jennifer, could you read for us verse 10? So Mark chapter 12, verse 10.
Have you not even read the scripture? The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
And verse 11. Sorry.
This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes.
Wow. So Jesus also, so he talks about the vineyard, but then he also brings in the stone. And Dennis, does it remind you of anything else, maybe in the Old Testament, of another stone?
Well, definitely in Daniel chapter 2, actually, uh-huh. A king had a very impressive dream named Nebuchadnezzar, which in that dream.
So he saw okay. the statue, this big yeah. statue. Okay, mm-hmm. the statue.
Right.
Okay.
So he saw a statue, but what was more impressive than the statue was actually a stone that came and actually smote that image or that statue at the feet.
Exactly.
And I like how the Bible actually just puts more emphasis on that stone, especially in verses 44 and 45. Two huge texts.
Okay, so it's Daniel chapter 2,
verses 44 and 45.
Okay, let's get there. And Dennis, if you could read for us.
Sure, allow me to tap there.
Daniel chapter 2, verses 44 and 45.
Yes,
right?
Got it. Okay. Okay. For us. Yeah. All right, and so here it says, catching up with technology, all right. It says, and in the days of these kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people. It shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. And it says, inasmuch as you saw that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God has made known to the king what will come to pass after this. Mm-hmm. The dream is certain, and its interpretation is sure.
So what we see, what is this, what does this stone represent then?
Jesus
and his
yeah.
kingdom. The kingdom of
his
God.
His kingdom, mm-hmm. because there were many other kingdoms, and now this new kingdom comes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Conquers.
And conquers and grows and grows and yes. grows and grows. It's powerful. Mm-hmm.
And this is just this is also very interesting because if we take a look, so here we see a play of words. Mm-hmm. There is a stone, but there's also a son, because this vine dresser, he sends a son.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But then Jesus refers to a stone. Mm-hmm. Mm. And I would like us to see this in Hebrew language, because if you mix the, if you for instance, even the word stone, if you take away T mm-hmm. and E at the end, what will you see?
Son.
The same in Hebrew. In Hebrew, it sounds like Ben is son, mm-hmm. or Ben is son. Ben is son. And then if you take a look at, so as you can see, Ben means son, mm-hmm. but the word Eben, means stone. Mm-hmm. So when Jesus was saying it, he's saying, you will reject the son, but that son will be the cornerstone. Mm-hmm. Or you will reject the stone, but I am the cornerstone. He's basically saying, I am that stone. Mm-hmm. I am the one who brings this kingdom, because this is what his message was.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. He said,
behold, the kingdom of heaven has come near. Mm-hmm. Now, let's see what happens. Let's see how lives are transformed. Let's see how you are changed. So now we establish this scene. Jesus is giving us, by presenting this parable, he gives us two choices. You can either reject the Son, mm-hmm. or you can accept the Son. Mm-hmm. And this is what we see here. Religious leaders, some of them rejected the Son, and some of them, not some of them, but regular people, it says.
Common people.
Common people mm-hmm. accepted the Son. And Jennifer, you read it for us, because they were afraid to take him because they were afraid of people.
Yeah.
They were following.
Right.
So now let's, and the following passage will tell us about how that kingdom of God has to be manifested. And who can give us a quick text about the Pharisees and taxes?
Okay.
Dennis, okay, give us a quick text about Pharisees and paying taxes. So we are in Mark chapter 12, verses 13, all the way to verse 17.
Yes, and so pretty much what happens is that the Pharisees and the Herodians, they team up together and they come to Jesus and they want to know, was it lawful mm-hmm. to give tribute to Caesar? And so Jesus says, you know, bring me a coin. Mm-hmm. And so he says, whose image is on the coin? And then he says, you have to render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's and render unto God the things that are God's. Yeah. But what was interesting is that the Pharisees really didn't like the Herodians. Yeah. They thought that they were untrue to their religion, but here they are, they're friends, mm-hmm. working together to try and trap Jesus.
Yeah. Common enemy.
Yeah, and I thought it was so interesting, it reminded me of a text in actually Luke 23, verse 12. If we can turn there and look at it, you'll find it's quite interesting.
Okay. Could you read them?
Luke chapter 23, verse 12.
Mm-hmm. Could you read for us?
Sure. And the Bible says, that very day Pilate and Herod became friends with each other, previously they had been at enmity with each other. Mm. And this is in the context of Jesus and the crucifixion that we'll see happening later on. Pilate sends Jesus to Herod, and now it says mm-hmm. that they were made friends, and before they were enemies. It's very interesting to see how enemies become friends when they're trying to persecute.
Right. Yeah. The enemy of my enemy is my friend.
Even a wrong cause is able to unite enemies. Mm-hmm. It's kind of weird how deep evil can grow and how evil in a sense can unite people to cause even more evil.
Mm. And this is exactly what we see even in today's world, because how can we see it in today's world when we stand against Jesus, we are united in this pursuit of mm-hmm. getting rid of Christianity, if you will. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so the first group that approached Jesus was the Pharisees and Herodians. And we need to take a look at who they were. Who are those Pharisees? So the Pharisees can be, it's a distinctive group in Judaism. Pharisees, they can be identified by three main characteristics. So first, they accepted oral law. So in addition to the Bible, they also accepted oral law. Second, they also believed in resurrection. And the third one, they opposed Hellenistic culture. What is Hellenistic culture at that time?
The modern Greek culture.
Exactly, the modern Greek culture. It's just like, for instance, in our world, we would oppose contemporary culture. Just like, so if we accept the oral law, additional traditions to the Bible, if we believe in resurrection, we can call almost ourselves Pharisees.
Pharisees.
Almost.
Okay.
But again, just almost, because we cannot even call ourselves Pharisees. But so just something of that nature, just like, for instance, when we accept the culture. So they were opposing the culture. Mm-hmm. And now, obviously, they would be opposing paying taxes to this culture that supports the culture.
Of course.
They would be. And in addition to that, in 6 CE, when Jesus was about probably 10 years old, there was a great revolt in Galilee.
Exactly.
And that great revolt was based on the fact that they didn't want to pay taxes. So Romans came and they crucified about 2,000 people.
Wow.
2,000 people just because they didn't want to pay taxes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So think about those Pharisees. Clever guys, aren't they?
Just like
they
Jesus.
Try.
What do they try to do? What are they trying to do now?
They're constantly trying to trap him and make him in opposition to the government so that the government will eliminate their problem.
Mm-hmm.
But I love Jesus' answer. It's so precise. He doesn't spend 5 years going on and on. I mean, this is not like a five-book response. Yeah. It's like a couple of verses, and he shuts them down. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of times with Christians, you know, we can write volumes on things that only require a sentence.
Yes. Yeah.
One Bible verse as opposed to 20 books.
Yeah, philosophical. Yeah.
That's why so Jesus cool. was Jesus, right?
That's why Jesus was Jesus.
Yeah, this is not, unfortunately, I wish we had that, I wish we imitated Jesus closely.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, but this is very good. And we have actually a hidden treasure prepared about this very occasion. Yeah. So let's check it out together. We don't think much of the change in our pocket now. But in the time of Jesus, a pious Jew would hate the idea of even touching a Roman coin. Why? That's the subject of today's hidden treasure. You see, the Jews were forbidden to make carved images of human beings. But right in the time of Jesus, Tiberius, the Roman emperor, started minting a coin that became one of the most offensive symbols for the Jews. Let's take a closer look at it together. Firstly, it included a clear carved image of the emperor. In addition to that, right around the head, it included an inscription that stated, Augustus Tiberius, son of the divine Augustus. On the other side, it continued, High Priest. So, here we see a coin that stated that Tiberius, the Roman emperor, was the son of a god and the high priest. To the Jews, the Romans could not have made a more offensive object if they had tried. So it is easy to see why a pious Jew would not want to carry this kind of coin in his pocket. This gives us a better understanding of what is happening in Mark 12, when the Pharisees and Sadducees try to trap Jesus again, asking, "Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" They were sure they had Jesus trapped. He would either support taxes to Caesar, angering the crowd, or by denouncing taxes, he would be found guilty by the Romans of a capital charge. The response of Jesus is simply amazing. "Why do you test me? Bring me a denarius that I may see it." The coin with the carved image of the emperor and the offensive inscriptions was brought to Jesus. And he replied, "Give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." So the coin bears Caesar's image. Therefore, it belongs to him. But what bears God's image? In Genesis 1:27, we read that we were created in God's image. The point of Jesus is clear. That coin was made by Caesar, belonged to him, and existed to glorify him. So give it back to him. God, on the other hand, created something far more valuable and precious to him than money, you. So in everything you do, give yourself to God, that he may be glorified. And that's today's hidden treasure. So we see how they tried to trap Jesus.
Yes. Yeah.
But by even that trap, Jesus presents a very important point of the true significance of the kingdom of God.
Mm-hmm.
Because in the kingdom of God, you belong to God.
Yes.
It's powerful.
Yeah.
And give to this world whatever belongs to this world.
And I think it's so good that you cleared it out there, Oleg, because this text has been misused throughout the centuries. Mm-hmm. It was used during the Civil War, telling that some people should still be obeying to a tyrant government, and it's still misused in many, many areas. You see, Jesus is telling to be obedient to kind of a tyrant government, and it's not what Jesus is talking about. He's saying exactly our identity. To whom do we belong? We belong to God and His creation. This is powerful because it changes a whole different perspective. Or to whom we give what we have and to whom we truly give our hearts to.
Mm-hmm. And if Jesus had said that they did not have to pay taxes, it would have been the equivalent of saying that we are now establishing a Jewish state.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because if a government does not have the authority to tax its citizens, it's not the government of those individuals, mm-hmm. right? Because they need that revenue to operate, to mm-hmm. pay soldiers, to pave the roads and do all of that stuff. So they knew what they were asking.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
If we have time, the other thing that I picked up on this, tying it into the one of the vineyard, return to God what is God's. Mm-hmm. That was something else that I saw in the vineyard. If they weren't willing to give to God what was his, their time, their tithe, their attention, their heart. And he's saying, yeah, money, the country, the government that you live under is one thing, but you also owe something back to God. And like you said, in the hidden treasure, it's us.
Mm. And the kingdom of God permeates all other kingdoms.
Amen.
Jesus didn't come to establish his own little kingdom in some other like distant part of the world. He said, no, from after my coming, every single country of this world, every single corner of this world will have the presence of my kingdom.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that's why we are his citizens. We have to take this very short break. And we will continue our lively discussion right after this break. And this is your time to share your thoughts on today's question. What does it mean to love God with all that you have?
Not long ago, I was traveling in New York City and I saw a sign on the subway. It had all the numbers for the code and said, the law says, don't spit on the floor. Now, it's amazing that I go to a lot of buildings and I don't see any signs that say, don't spit on the floor. I guess the signs are there because they need them there to help regulate behavior, because you probably wouldn't want to have a lot of people spitting on the floor. Do you know that God has given us gracious instruction to help us live in the best way? That instruction that comes in the Bible and the Ten Commandments and the life of Jesus shows us the best way to live. But you know, God doesn't want us just to look at that instruction and say, oh, I guess I better do it because God said so. He wants us to recognize that that really is the best way to live. And he puts his Spirit in us so that we come to want to live the way that would be best for us. Now, would you rather live in a place where they have to put signs on the wall to say don't spit on the floor? Or would you rather live in a place where people just don't do that because they really don't want to? Wouldn't it be nice if we could live in a place where everyone accepted God's gracious instruction and lived the way that He knows is best for us?
Welcome back. The study of the Word of God sets our hearts on fire. And if you feel the same, don't keep it to yourself. Share your comments. Diego, do we have a couple of comments?
Yeah, we do. We have a couple here. The first one is on Facebook. It's from Ren. And for me, this means loving God with our thoughts, our time, our talents, and our resources. It is not the easiest thing to do. Giving our all is about sacrificing self, which is not possible without real love. And one text from Pam saying, when we truly love God with our hearts, we give Him our all. We don't let any filth into our minds. We become stronger as we study His Word. Ren and Pam, thank you so much for your comments, and continue sending your answers to our question. This is powerful. This is amazing, our cross connection, that we still have people. It is not only us having a conversation here, but it's everybody out there. So
join us.
Send your comments, please. Yeah.
Exactly. So our second group, which is a very unique group. So we just talked about the fact that Jesus presents this very sad parable. Mm-hmm. But it's also at the same time very beautiful parable, because Jesus says, you basically will crucify me, mm-hmm. because I am the Son of the Father. I am God Himself who decided to descend so that He could tell you what the reason of this kingdom is about, mm-hmm. and what the purpose of this kingdom is. And then we talked about the Pharisees and the Herodians who tried to trap Him, and they wanted Romans to kill Him. Mm-hmm. That's why they brought this coin. And now we will talk about the Sadducees. And before we talk about, can you give us a quick text,
yes,
Jillian?
Yes, quick text. So this is for Mark chapter 12, verses 18 through 27. The Sadducees, what about the resurrection, is what my Bible heading is. So the Sadducees are trying to trick Him because that's their thing. And they do not believe in the resurrection. So they're asking him, using the example of the tradition of marriage. If a woman marries the oldest brother and he dies, the next brother marries her, then the next, the next. So they say, okay, well, Jesus, if this woman marries seven brothers, mm-hmm. who will she be married to at the resurrection? And they're trying to catch him off guard with that response. And he basically says, no, you're wrong. Mm-hmm. Our God is not the God of the living, but our God is the God of the living, living yes. but not the God of the dead.
Yeah. Excellent, so. Excellent, excellent. Thank you so much. So this is what we see, the Sadducees. So let's take a look at the characteristics of the Sadducees. They also had three main characteristics.
Very good.
First characteristic of the Sadducees, they rejected oral law. Remember what Pharisees did?
They loved oral law.
They loved oral law. These guys reject oral
it.
Law.
Yeah.
Second characteristic, they rejected resurrection. What about the Pharisees?
They believed in it.
They believed in resurrection. So these guys rejected resurrection. And the third one, they promoted Hellenistic culture. Remember the mm-hmm. other guys? Mm. They opposed it. But these guys promote Hellenistic mm-hmm. culture. So you see those differences. So the Sadducees, and obviously they don't believe in resurrection. So their question would be about
the resurrection.
To trick Jesus. I mean, this is like it's like a plot. Everybody's trying to catch Jesus in something.
It's
right?
like a hobby with them.
Sure.
Every day they want to try to trip him up.
But they're trying to show that the resurrection couldn't legitimately happen. I mean, they're trying to come up with scenarios that would make the resurrection seem
too
like
complicated.
Just like ridiculous.
Yeah. Or against what the law is that they have.
And I really like how Jesus answered, because he went back to the Old Testament, to the burning bush in Exodus.
Yeah. Exactly.
And he says
and
that he's
what
the,
they believe.
Yeah.
They accepted the five for five.
They accepted the written
Pentateuch.
God. So they accepted the Torah, accepted the prophets, and also. Yeah.
Yeah, and he even mentions that. He says that he's the. He remembered that when from the bush, he said, I am the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. And what was so interesting, at that time, where was Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? They were dead. So he was pointing forward to the kingdom that was to come, that they would be in the kingdom, resurrected.
This is good. So what can we learn by looking at the response of Jesus to the Sadducees?
He relied on scripture, and he was very concise.
Yeah.
Back to the fact that he was very
like
concise.
He,
and go
he,
on and
he
on
was
for days.
Cross Connection, it would be probably about 2 minutes long program.
And that would be enough, right? We'll be like, wow.
I know. Let's go home after 2 minutes.
The beautiful thing that I love about Jesus is that he makes it so palatable for them. Mm-hmm. He's not trying to present new doctrines and new things, mm-hmm. but he's saying, this is what you know. You just aren't understanding it,
wow,
how it's meant
so
to be.
Good, Jimmy.
Yeah.
This is every single
dialogue.
This is so powerful, but at the same time, there is another lesson that we also need to learn, that trust in God.
Yes.
Just like, because remember what was so unique about Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? What was so unique about Abraham? In Hebrews chapter 11, we can read about, by faith, he stepped out, he trusted God to the point of death,
right.
Even though he died, he knows that he still has his God.
Reward. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The same about Isaac, even though they had their issues, but he trusted God. Jacob, even more issues, but he still trusted God.
Right.
Yeah.
So this trust, and even if you don't believe in resurrection, which you should, because because when God, Jesus Christ himself was resurrected,
amen.
And we celebrated that festival not so long ago. If Jesus had resurrected, then you surely will be resurrected.
Amen.
If you choose Jesus
amen.
As the Son of God who mm-hmm. can enter into your heart.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Let's trust him.
Amen.
Yeah, that'd be like the same.
And I think it was what you mentioned, Oleg, it's great because, I mean, if whether you were a believer or non-believer, you can always get into conversations. People want, what would be eternal life like? I mean, are you going to be in heaven? Are you going to be jumping in clouds? Are we going to marry? Or what's going to happen? And as you're saying, even Paul says, I have not seen, ears have not heard what God is in store for those who love him.
Amen.
And can you imagine this? I mean, the Bible...
We can't.
We might have a little glimpse in if you read what heaven or everlasting life is going to be like. But eventually, when we really see and experience in it, that's what it says, taste and see how...
Yes.
We're going to be totally amazed.
That's why when Jesus comes, experience the kingdom of God here.
Right here now.
Right.
Because he's giving to you this life right now. That's why rejoice and know that you will be resurrected. Let's continue moving forward.
Amen.
And the third group that approaches Jesus is, help me,
the scribes.
Mm-hmm. The scribes. And Diego, could you give us a quick text for the scribes?
Oh, yeah, sure. Well,
it's in Mark chapter 12, verses 28 all the way to verse 34.
Okay, okay, I'm just going to do a quick text here. So the scribes approach Jesus and ask, what is the greatest commandment of all, right? This famous question. Jesus answered, well, love the Lord with all your heart, with everything that you have, with all your might, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. And mm-hmm. and then they say, well, Rabbi, you answered really well. And Jesus says, well, you also did, and you are not far from the kingdom. But that's pretty much Jesus right here. He summarizes the entire Bible in these two simple sentences.
Yeah. And yeah, this is a very, very important point. So let's take a look at the third group. And those guys, they also had three characteristics.
Of course they did.
Yeah, but this is just our characteristics. So first, they were just copyists and teachers.
Yeah.
That's why they're called scribes. Mm-hmm. So they were copyists and teachers. Then second characteristic, which is also important, is they associated with Pharisees, Sadducees, and Essenes. Essenes is the third group, because there were Pharisees, Sadducees, and there was a third group, Essenes. And this is just two points. So 2 points is enough. So about Essenes, just quickly, because there was Pharisees and there was another group of Essenes. They're not mentioned in the Bible, but historically we know that they existed. And mm-hmm. if you want to know more about it, you can contact us. Make sure to do that. So this is what those groups, so they associated themselves with everybody, mm-hmm. but they were the ones who kept the law. Mm-hmm. They knew every law, everything. They were copying even the scripture and all the laws. So obviously their question would be on the laws. But how did Jesus, Jesus didn't present anything new here, but how and what does it mean to love God and love your neighbor as yourself? It's not that easy to fulfill.
No, it isn't. And I'm not really sure which one is easier.
To love God or love your neighbor? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Easier or hardest?
Well, however you want to look at it. But I think it's easy to think that we're loving God by loving our neighbor, mm-hmm. or that we actually are loving our neighbor. Oh, I'm nice to you and I'm treating you as I want to be treated. But is that all it takes?
This is a very good question and point. And because I think there is something that we can learn, something very interesting that we can learn by taking a quick look at the passage that Jesus quotes, actually. Because Jesus here, he doesn't just come up with something that he doesn't present mm-hmm. anything new.
Right.
He bases his response on the Old Testament. Mm-hmm. Let's take a look at Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. So Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. And I would like us to see Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, as well as Mark chapter 12, verse 30. So compare them. So let's take a Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. And Julian, could you read for us?
Sure.
6:5.
You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength.
Okay, so this is in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. And we see that there is something added in Deuteronomy chapter, in Mark chapter 12, verse 30. It says, all your heart, can you read it? I would like us to see it on the screen if it's possible. So as you can see, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength, with all your mind. But if you take a look at Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, it doesn't mention
mind.
Mind, exactly. It doesn't mention mind. But let's take a look at another translation. Because if you look at another translation, and it's just a verbal translation of the Hebrew Bible in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your very.
Exactly.
What? It doesn't say strength.
Very what?
Very what? And that is exactly the question. Love your God with your very? What does it mean? And this is what Jesus quotes.
To the extreme? To as much as possible?
And let's find out what it means after the break. So let's take a very short break right now, but now is the last chance to share your thoughts on today's question. What does it mean to love God with all that you have? Welcome back. We are discussing the Gospel of Mark chapter 12. And we took a quick look at three groups of people who approached Jesus, religious leaders. And the last one is a very, very unique group. And I would like us to take a look at this slate again to see the translation of the Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. Again, you will see that God says, Moses, when Moses was writing it, with all your heart, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, literal translation, with all your, love your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your very. This is very peculiar, isn't it?
I think it's great.
You think it's great?
Yeah.
Yeah. But why do you think it's great?
Because it's all-encompassing, because it's so easy to feel like you've done your part, mm-hmm. but the original text is saying, no, everything, mm-hmm. not just a little bit here and there when it's convenient and when you feel like it, but everything, what we have is his.
But I think this is like, we believe that Moses wrote the book of Deuteronomy.
Yeah.
So imagine that he's writing it and he's just like, love your God with all your soul and with all your very.
Yeah.
Just very, just because if I say possession, then I would limit you to only whatever you have.
Yeah, exactly.
But no, everything.
If you think about this, words, they bring meaning. Mm-hmm. But they also, they limit us.
Yeah. Okay.
Have you ever felt like a way you just have no words to mm-hmm. express something? Mm-hmm. I just imagine that Moses was kind of feeling like that. As a matter of fact, you have a couple of comments here that actually, they might actually help us even to expand on what we're saying. One is from Shannon on Facebook, and this is what he says. I think to love God with all that we have means fervently asking Him to give and guide our willingness to serve Him. Obey Him even when it may seem inconvenient or difficult, and fulfilling His will even if it means sacrificing our lives in love for others and for Him. Shannon, thank you so much for your comment. I mean, this is really, really powerful because not always will be convenient, right, to serve God. And the other one is from Adebukola. I hope I got this right. To receive all of God, His yes and no, His hard saying and His easy sayings. To love so that in spite of what God has laid before us, we keep drawing near to Him and do not pull away. Thank you so much again for your comment. This is so powerful because this is true. Sometimes it's we want to, oh Lord, may my will be done and not yours. Instead of praying like Jesus, it's your will, not mine. Mm-hmm. And to love God is a relationship. Sometimes He might ask you something you might not understand, you might don't want to do it at the moment. But ultimately, it's for our own benefit. Mm-hmm.
This is so great. Let's just bring ourselves back to the setting for a few seconds. So we are, again, where are we at the moment with Jesus?
In temple.
Close
awesome
to the temple.
Temple.
The temple.
Around the temple.
Our awesome temple right here. Yes. Not our, but yeah, that's the temple. Imagine that. right here at the temple. And it's Tuesday. So most likely it's Tuesday. So Tuesday, just in 2 days, Jesus will be crucified. So now He's at the temple. He wants all of us to understand the most important messages. Mm-hmm. And He's attacked. And in while He's attacked, He's presenting the three most important messages right here, right here and right now.
Wow. Amen.
Three most important messages for the entire Christianity. Mm-hmm. All Christianity is based on those three messages. First, give everything that you are to God because you are created in His image.
Mm-hmm. Powerful.
Secondly, He says, the resurrection will happen. Trust me. Mm-hmm. And thirdly, love God with all your very and love your neighbor as yourself. Mm-hmm. This is the fundamentals of Christianity.
Yeah.
In this
so
one day. In this
and one day, and it probably took Him like 15 minutes to say it.
Yeah. And it took us 1 hour to talk about it.
No.
But this
it's
is
powerful.
Amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
How do we live it today? How do you experience it today? How do you love God with all your heart?
Well, see, the thing that I love about Jesus is that He clarifies what the Old Testament says. So we don't have to guess what very means in Deuteronomy because we can just read what Jesus says God meant here when it says with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. But even better than just making sure we understand the words of the Old Testament, He also shows us how to love God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. So He gives us teaching, but He also gives us an example. And I think if we follow Jesus' example, we never have to guess how we should be loving God.
This is so great.
And others.
Exactly. That is exactly why in John chapter 1, John says, in the beginning was the Word.
And
in this case, Jesus has become this literal Word of God that walks.
Amen.
And by it's not just us reading only, but
it's
also
us watching Him.
Yes.
Exactly.
This is so good.
And what's so interesting also is that in John, in his epistles, he also talks about the love that we have for our brothers. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes the way how we treat one another, it shows a reflection of our relationship with God. Mm-hmm. We don't take time to focus on that. So if I'm not so nice, you know, to my brother or my sister, or even I can say if I'm not so nice to my mother or even, you know, my father, my friends, that shows the relationship I have with God. If I'm dishonest with my friends, if I'm not giving my all for my friends, and yet at the same time I'm saying I'm giving all for God, you can see the disconnect. He said it goes hand in hand.
Very good.
You love God, and you will also love your neighbor as yourself.
This is so powerful, because remember what was the first one when the Pharisees approached Jesus? Mm-hmm. What bears the image of God?
We do.
People.
Yeah.
We
people.
All do. So when you treat others, remember that he also bears the image of God. Mm-hmm. That is all. She or a child. Mm-hmm. We all bear the image of God.
Yeah. And I love that this is Jesus's. It's the Bible's consistent theme, even in the Old Testament. Looking at the Ten Commandments, it's how you relate to God and honor him and revere him, and how you relate to your brethren. And throughout the New Testament and Jesus' teaching, he's not saying, well, here are men and here are women. He's saying, no, you were created to be partners in marriage.
Exactly.
And it's not, the children are not worthy. It's no, all of you are my children. And it's just, it's not love the people who you say are better or who you think are better. It's everyone. We are all his. It's exciting.
This is great. This is powerful.
Great. Yeah. And I think also love needs to be taught. It needs to be grown. It needs to be cultivated, right?
Be models.
And thank you so much for all of you who are sending your answers. We're having a lot of answers in here. For our friend Jester is saying, I think it is still important to spend time with him despite our busy schedule. In fact, he should always be the priority and not someone we can just turn on when we have a spare time. Mm. Another way to show love is what? Is spending
time
with people. And this is on Facebook also. Fortunato also said, look how simple this is, but powerful. It means to love God as he had loved us. And sometimes we do not know how to love people. We don't know. But if you look at Jesus, as we've been saying here, Jesus is the key, is the source. Jesus is walking love. Yeah. If you learn how to love, we've got to look at Jesus Christ.
And
thank you so much for your comments, guys.
And there's so much that we can unpack from that and what love looks like. It's not hearts and pink and purple and Valentine's Day. Exactly. It's
not
so
our
much
cliche
more than that.
Terms, but
exactly.
it's something even much greater.
Yeah.
Well, this is so great. And it's fascinating because this very chapter, it ends with a very beautiful picture at the temple. When the little lady, this woman, comes, poor woman, comes and she donates her money to this temple that was corrupt. Think about that. It's just like, it's so incredible. Such an important lesson. She feels like, okay, this is still to God. This is still to God. And what Jennifer, could you give us very quickly, what is that story and what do we see there?
Sure. And I think it's just contrasted with the story right before it, where Jesus was saying, beware of the scribes and who like to walk around with fancy clothes on and be greeted and have people say, oh, you're so important. I can tell you're an important religious person. So he contrasts that to this widow who goes to the temple and she gives the last little bit of money that she has. And in that society, a fancy person with fancy clothes would have been considered very important, and that would have been the person to honor. Exactly. But a widow would have been considered next to nothing, and a poor widow would have been considered even below that.
Exactly.
And this is what Jesus presents once again. You know what? My kingdom consists of everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Because everyone who comes and wants to love me with everything that you have, it comes to anything and everything, mind, strength, and everything. Yes.
And I think that's a good point that you brought out, because you could even see in the world today the ones that we despise, like the poor ones.
Yeah.
I mean, they have the image of God too. And how do we love them? You know, oftentimes I know, when I'm in New York walking on the street, people come up to me and ask me for money. I know they need help. I don't have it. But sometimes what I'll do, I'll give them a track and I'll just pray with them, taking the time, because you never know. That can be, an angel that you can entertain. And so even in those little instances, God is just trying to teach us to love. But oftentimes we're like the scribes, we're like the Pharisees, and we're like the Sadducees, and it's sad.
And love, I believe, love is not a feeling. Love is a decision. Love is an action. Sometimes you might not feel like loving, but if you do it, you do it more. You're not being hypocritical. You're just trying to make love natural to you, and eventually becomes.
And I like what was mentioned also, too, the fact that it might not be convenient. For example, sometimes I'm in such a rush to just get to the train, and then somebody would come and they start talking to me. I'm like, listen, I'm really busy right now. I have to go. And then looking back at it, I'm like, man, because it wasn't convenient, I chose not to serve. Wow. I chose not to love. Mm-hmm. And so just little things like that really.
We have only 30 seconds left. So what is your takeaway lesson in 5 seconds?
Love. I mean, love everyone. Love with your very. Excellent. Whatever that is. God will show you what it is.
Excellent.
Yeah. And don't neglect the opportunities to serve and to be a minister to others.
Excellent.
Yeah, just love like Jesus and you'll get it right every time.
Yeah. Love comes first, always. That's my takeaway lesson.
Yeah, this is just, I was truly blessed, and I could see how the kingdom of God was coming near.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Amen.
Because we felt that Jesus was truly present with us. Thank you so much for joining us, and I was truly blessed. And
Amen.
I hope you were blessed as well, and thank you for being a part of our discussion. Jesus was confronted by three different groups who tried to trap him. But each of his responses presents another depth of meaning. Holding a coin, Jesus said that you belong to God because you bear His image. Mm. When answering the question on resurrection, Jesus encouraged us to trust Him and to trust God fully. And by presenting the greatest commandments, He demonstrated what it really means to be in union with God. Love your God with all your heart, all your soul, and your very all. And love your neighbor as you love yourself. And let the word of God, let the words of Jesus Christ transform you. Until next week, stay connected with Jesus in your everyday life and also here on Cross Connection. Thank you very much.
I was, I was, yeah.